Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, welcome to a new episode. In this episode, we are going to speak about the burning bush. It is a big, big problem in the Coptic Orthodox Church. Before I go into the body of the message or the episode, let's have a sort of introduction. The first part of the introduction is, in the second century, a person named Origen, we all know him, came with the idea that is called allegorical interpretation of the Bible. He was like a philosophical person, and he could see in every line in the Bible allegorical interpretation other than the, like I would say, the what actually the Holy Spirit meant by the text itself. But actually this led up, it is not bad to have this allegorical interpretation, just to use it as a spiritual reflection, and you can pray with it. But if you make it as a dogma, then actually came into a heresy. Of course, he didn't mean to go to the heresy, but eventually this is what happened. Second century, and also the other father of it, also Saint Augustine, in the 5th century, he came again and they like revived it and they added a lot more of it. Okay. Also, you know, in the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, the last verse, and chapter 45, the first verse, there is a prophecy. Let's read it, then explain it. The last verse of Isaiah 44. Who is talking about Yahweh or God, says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure, saying to Jerusalem, you shall be built, and to the temple, your foundation shall be laid. Isaiah 44. Who is Cyrus? Cyrus actually is a Gentile emperor or leader or king that actually came. He was born after this prophecy 150 years. So in other words, the Lord himself mentioned the name of this person before he was born 150 years, and he's not an Israelite guy. And the prophecy says that this person by this name, he will be the one that will be returning the people of Israel from the exile of Babylon and will issue the decree or the orders for Jerusalem to be built and the temple to be also built. And this actually happened, all right? So, but this is a prophecy. If we watch the whatever called temple coin that issued very recently by Israel, you will see on one side is a photo of the temple, and on the other side, a photo of two persons, Cyrus, which is this guy, and Trump. So what is the relationship between Cyrus and Trump? Cyrus is the exact person that the prophecy meant him to be. But the Jews also saw in Trump a copy or like a replica of Cyrus. Why? Because Trump, like just say, Jerusalem is the capital city, and he began to say Israel must build the temple because this is the only place they can worship and should be built in this place. So the Israelites saw in Trump as another Cyrus, but the prophecy meant exactly Cyrus, the guy that actually he was a Persian guy. He issued the decree like to the Jews to go back to their home country and to build the city of Jerusalem and also the temple. So one is, I would say, the exact one, the other one is like a copy one. Okay, this is just introduction before I go to the burning bush. Now let's take another one as introduction. In the book of Jeremiah, let's read some stuff in chapter 1. Chapter 1. Then the word of the Lord came to me, to Jeremiah, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctify you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Of course, this is a vision. Then said I, then Jeremiah said, Ah, Lord God, behold, I can't speak for I am a youth. He's trying like to get out of this mission because he says, I'm too young. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, like a young boy, or like he thought himself is not capable for such a big mission. Then the Lord continued, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. Why? And the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. So you will not be the speaker, I will receive be the speaker. You are like just the microphone. See, I have this day set you over all the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. So this is an encouraging thing. In the same chapter, then the Lord will show him two visions. Let's go step by step. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? So he showed him something in a vision. And said, I see a branch of almond tree. Watch, the word the almond in Hebrew is shakode. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well, for I am ready. The word ready in Hebrew, shakod. So one shakode, the other one is shakod. The word almond is shakode. The word I'm ready is shakod, to perform my word. So before we go, now you understand what does it mean, this little vision. It's a branch of shakod or shakode, and I'm ready, I'm shakod. Like, because the two words very close to each other. So the Lord telling him, I am shakod, shakode. You understand? So he showed him this to assure to him, I will make it. I'm ready to, it's about to happen. And I'm ready to do it. Then he showed him another vision. Okay, now try to understand this, because this will be now, will make us very easily understanding the burning bush. And the word of the Lord came to me second time, saying, what do you see? Another vision. And he said, I see a boiling pot, and it's facing away from the north. So the Lord showed him a pot boiling, and it's facing towards the north. The north, of course, of Israel, or the Judah's kingdom. Then the Lord said to me, out of the north, calamity shall break forth on all inhabitants of the land. Of course, the land, he meant the land of Judah. For behold, I am calling all the families of kingdoms of the north, saying the Lord, they shall come, and each one set his throne at the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem, against all its walls and around, and against all the cities of Judah. I will utter my judgment against them concerning all their wickedness, because they have forsaken me, burned incense to the gods, and worshipped the works of their own hands. Therefore, prepare yourself and arise, and speak to them all that I command you. Do not be dismayed before their faces, lest I dismay you before them. For behold, I have made you this day a fortified city and an iron pillar and bronze walls against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, against the princes, against its priests, and against the people of the land. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you, for I am with you, says the Lord, to deliver you. Jeremiah, all this is just Jeremiah 1. My question now is there any relationship between the vision of this pot boiling to and facing the north, and what the Lord says to Jeremiah, of course. So the vision has a meaning for his mission. The vision has a meaning for his mission. He showed him what is going to happen, and he said, now we have to go and tell people. By the way, this vision was fulfilled less than 30 years. I think about 25 years after that, yes, the Babylon came into Jerusalem, destroyed it, and they exiled the people there. So there was a relationship between what the Lord showed Jeremiah and what he said to him. Okay? Now this is the introduction. It's finished. Now let's come to the burning bush. Let's find out about the burning bush. What the burning bush is talking. Now we start with Genesis 15, then we go to the vision of the burning bush. Genesis 15, it has something to do with the burning bush. Now, when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abraham. And behold, horror and great darkness fell upon him like a nightmare. Then he, the Lord, said to Abraham, know certainly that your descendants, so this darkness, great, or this horror thing, or this, you can say, nightmare, has something. Your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years, very specifically. And although, and also the nation whom they serve, I will judge afterwards, they shall come out with great positions. Now, as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. Like you will die in peace, you will not see this. This happened more than 200 years later. You shall be buried at a good old age. At a good old age. But in the fourth generation, he's affirming to him again, that in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. So there is like a vision or a prophecy about, it was given to Abraham, that your descendants that will inherit this land, but will, before they inherit this land, they will go as strangers and will be slaves in a far land, and they will stay there for 4 years or 400 years or like four generations. But after that, don't worry, I fulfill my promise. They will come back with great positions, and like they will not be consumed or destroyed or vanished in this land because of the afflictions that they will suffer from. Okay, so this happened. Now we come to this situation. This vision, now Moses will see, is nearly about 600 years after the first vision, because after the vision of Abraham, about 200 years they went to Egypt, they stayed there 400 years, then the Lord appeared now to Moses. So can you follow the timing? Now Moses, after he actually fled from Egypt after killing the Egyptian guy and went to be like a shepherd in the desert of Sinai, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert, and they came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of the fire from the midst of the of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. It's very strange. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, and he said, here I am. Then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. So the Lord now is preparing him. There is a vision. Let me have a look. Then the Lord now telling him, he's going to introduce himself to him. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look up upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry. Watch now the words, the compassion of the Lord towards them. I have seen the oppression. I have heard their cry because their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hittites and the Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Exodus 3. Now, my very little question. Do you think that there is any relationship between the burning bush as not consumed and what the Lord explained to Moses? The vision and the mission. Is there any relationship between the vision and the mission? Of course, there is a direct, not even indirect, it's a very direct illustration that my people are weak, they are surrounded with the oppression, but you are not consumed. So, like, because I have to fulfill the promise with Abraham that they must go back and inherit all this land, so they will never be consumed. And now it's the time, because the 400 years is over, and you are the person that is going to go to Pharaoh and ask him to bring my people out. And this is what actually happened. So the vision and the mission was just marrying. That's it. Now, this is what actually the Holy Spirit meant. This is to show to Moses what's going to happen, and to show us and the Israelites to know, because I'm quite sure that Moses mentioned this vision many times to assure to the people, the Lord have seen your sorrows, you will not be consumed, 100% will go out. But according now to allegorical interpretation, it became like gradually moving from one thing to the other until it came to a heresy. And now the only interpretation that this burning bush is Saint Mary. Not at all, not whatsoever. This is a heresy when it says that. But it didn't happen at once, by the way. It happened gradually. So let's now we'll go to the book of interpretation or commentary on the book of Exodus by Father Tadros Ya'ub Malati, one of the very highly regarded priests in the Coptic Orthodox Church. And I'm reading from his book, what the fathers said about this. Number one, he said, we have seven interpretation. He says, the book of Midrash, before we go further, the book of Midrash is a Jewish book, is a commentary on, it is similar to the book that I'm reading from. It's a commentary on or explanation of the Bible to the Jews, or the Old Testament, of course. It's a Jewish book. What this Jewish book says, it refers to Israel surrounded by thorns and sufferings. Makes sense. This is the only one. Now, next. Go to the next one. Number two. Before I go to number two up to seven, I'll tell you something. As of just after the era of the epistle or apostles, I would say after the first century and even the first half of the second, the fathers of the church after that, they were all Gentiles, not Jews. Like I would see, like origin, like we see Augustine, John Chrysostom, Saint Cyril, they call him Saint Cyril, anyway, they had in their hearts hatred toward Jews. So anything related to the Jews began to say, it's for the church. It's a prophecy about the church. This is what's going to happen. All right? So this is the only interpretation that makes sense, the one that we read. But in fact, the exact one that it was, it's very simple. Give this text to a child in grade 6. He will tell you this vision is related to the mission, and he will explain it to you easily. Now we come again, what the father Tadros says in his book, number 2. He says, Tertullian, this is 2nd and the 3rd century. All right? At that time, the idea of St. Mary was not like shining like now, or like a 5th century. He says, referring to the sufferings, a church, but not consumed. So he is not saying it's about the Jews. He said about the church. Of course, absolutely, like, this is wrong. Could be a reflection. Even you took it on your own, that a person sometimes going through a fire, but the Lord will keep you, and you pray like that. Yes, this is just a reflection, like something that you you pray with. Lord, I understand I'm going through a hard time, but I trust in you will keep me, and I will not be consumed by all this fire. Yes, but when Moses saw this vision, and even the Lord explained it to him, it was nothing to do with you or with the church. It's something to do with what? His mission. My people will never be consumed. There is a verse, I don't know, I'm going to translate it on the top of my head. It says, I think in the book of Acts, I guess, it says about the sufferings of the Israelites. As much as they persecuted them, they actually grew, because actually they were trying to consume them, I mean the Egyptians. So, but the Bible says, as much as they tried to consume them, to destroy them, to afflict them, in fact, they grew and prospered. They could not be consumed. All right? Now, number 3. Hippolytus of Rome, 2nd and 3rd century. Again, God unites with his saints of the church as the fire in the bush. Moses saw the sufferings, a church of Christ surrounded by the thorns, but is full of the divine spirit, so death cannot overcome her. This is the ministry that he was called for. He's about Moses. This is young. Why? Moses was not called for this mission. Moses was called for a mission not related to the church of the New Testament, to the Jewish, to take them out. So how come Hippolytus of Rome? Because they hate Jews. They hate Jews. They don't want to speak about them. Because he says this is the ministry he was called for. No, he was not called for a ministry or a vision related to the New Testament church, which happened about 1600 years later. He was called for salvation, or is the exodus of the Jews to go out for the fulfillment of the promise of the Lord to Abraham, or to Abraham, that his people must come out. Has nothing to do with the Church of the New Testament. This is go to number 4. St. Augustine. It refers to the glory of God which dwelled in the midst of the Jews people, but did not consume the hardness of their hearts that are filled with the sword. Again, he would like to accuse the Jews that they had the glory of God in them, but the thorns are their heart hardness and did not consume. Of course not. It meant that the bush is the weak item in this vision, should be consumed by the fire, which is the fire is the oppression and the sorrows and the affliction of the Egyptians that is in the Jews, but will not consume them. They will not vanish. I will save them. This is the exact thing. But he's going around the bush. He said, it is related to the Jews, but he would like to accuse them that their heart is hard. Yeah, this is true. But the vision is not about showing their hardness, the hardness of their heart, showing that they are weak because the thorn is weak before the fire. So the fire is there, but the thorn, the bush, is not consumed. All right? So they were weak. They were slaves in Egypt. They were, many times they tried like to totally destroy them. But the Lord kept them. Okay? Number five. Saint Clement of Alexandria, 2nd and 3rd century. By the way, Saint Augustine, 5th century. Now, Saint Clement of Alexandria, it is a declaration of the virgin birth. Has nothing to do with this. If he's going to take the people out, why the Lord will show him the virgin birth? Has nothing to do with this. Moses did not understood it this way, by the way. Birth, as Jesus Christ was born of the virgin, and even this birth did not dissolve her virginity. What this to do with the vision? What this to do with the mission of Moses? Nothing. It's just, they try now to just put like that. And all we know now come number six, Cyril of Alexandria. A long one, 5th century. Referring to the mystery of the incarnation as divinity united with humanity without consuming the human nature, for Moses would not, this is a disaster, for Moses would not be able to start this act of salvation to the people like taking them from Egypt without touching the shadows of the divine incarnation. This has not... What's his mission? Has nothing to do with the incarnation. He wouldn't know. He wouldn't understand it. What this to do with the incarnation? The main idea, get out of the proper one of the Israelites. Now, John the Chrysostom said it is a reference to the resurrection of Jesus. Why do you show Moses the resurrection of Jesus while actually he's going to take the people out of Egypt after all these sorrows? Has nothing to do with this. Now, we've seen now seven. My comment on this. The Jewish one is the closest one that it refers to Jews, which is true. The rest of the reflections of the fathers could be used as reflections. And by the way, they vary a lot. They vary a lot. Some said it is about the incarnation. Some one said about the resurrection. Some said about the virginity of Saint Mary. So now I just would like to say, when you say we understand the Bible as the Father says, so which one you take? Which one now you embrace? I show you now. The one you embrace is the heresy one. Okay. So when say the Father said that, don't believe them. Don't say. As a start, tell them which father you follow. Which one you follow. Why don't you take the interpretation of, for example, of Saint John Chrysostom? You like him very much. He's very highly regarded in the Coptic Orthodox Church. Why don't you take his interpretation that this is referring to the resurrection of Jesus? Because you don't like this one. And even you don't want the real one, which easily you can see. Okay. Now, there is one more comment before I go to it. Let's see the heresy. Okay? Then we'll come back. Now, did you see? Now, the only interpretation that is embraced by the Coptic Orthodox Church now is the burning bush is Saint Mary. Full stop. That's it. Has nothing to do with the mission that Moses was going to. This what? This is corruption of the Bible. This is corruption of the Bible. Why you twist it this way? They hate Jews. They don't want them to be saved. They don't think that they will be saved. They don't want the temple to be built, but it will be built. So they hate them. So they just wipe them out from the whole Bible. All right. Now I have a very severe interpretation now. If now we open the door for this allegorical interpretation of the Bible, now, the burning bush would represent a weak person, a weak nation, is surrounded by persecution and will be saved and will continue, right? Exactly like when the Jews saw in Trump another copy of Cyrus. So accordingly, you can put this burning bush as a prophecy to anyone comes after Moses. Give example. You say the church, okay, that's fine. I'll be very now like, what about anyone after Moses and even until today can claim, especially if they say we believe in the Bible, can claim that burning bush is referring to their prophet. I'll give you an example. How about Muhammad? He came 610 AD. He was rejected by his own people. Then he went to Medina. He is back and his mission. And you know that his people now, like more than 20% of the population of the world. Now Muslims can take this and say, this is a prophecy about Muhammad, about his mission. He was young, yeah, like he's weak and they surrounded with persecution, and his mission was successful. The same with Mirza Baha'ullah, who established the Baha'i faith in year 1836, way after Muhammad. Again, he came with an idea, persecuted, and plenty of people, even in Egypt, some Baha'i. He can say, by the way, they believe in the Bible. They can say, the burning bush refers to us. Later on, Ghulam Mirza Ahmad, the one who established Ahmadiyya sect. Year 1889. They all, the Ahmadiyya, I know some of them, and I spoke to many of them. They believe in the Bible. And of course, they believe the Quran as well with a different meaning, interpretation of the Quran. They can, he did not say, but they can say the burning bush again refers to their sect because they are very weak. Until today, they are under persecution, but still the mission is still ongoing. So this is a disaster if you take not what the Bible actually meant, not what the Holy Spirit meant, and you make a reflection, and after that you make it as a dogma. Once you make it a dogma, this is a heresy. And this is what the Coptic Church did. So, as you can see, please go and read on your own. Don't listen to them. Now it's in the minds of people. Once they hear about the burning bush, St. Mary. No, it is not St. Mary at all. It is about the mission that Moses was about to go. And the Lord was supporting him, showing him, explaining to him, and then telling him, you go, because you will bring them out. They will not be consumed. Full stop. That's it. Okay. Thank you very much for your time. Unless the Lord comes, we'll meet again in another episode. Salam al-Masih.